Hi guys, welcome back to the channel. Today we are continuing our E30 sort of guide series, and today we're actually going to be looking at the things you need to know when maintaining your E33 series. So we're going to be looking at a bunch of different things actually, some things that are specific to the E33 series, and then just other things that you probably need to know about owning a 30-year-old car. I'm going to try and differentiate this a little bit to the buyer's guide and some of the other points that I've mentioned in both the review and the living with an E30 boot video. So some of the points we're going to be covering is the engine and just whole drivetrain, actually, the things you need to know there, as well as the suspension, brakes, and exhaust setups. I'll also cover the sort of like day-to-day maintenance things that you need to be aware of just to try and keep them looking in as best shape as possible. And as usual with this type of video, this is purely my opinion. It's always worth doing your own research and just looking up your own facts as well. I'm no E30 encyclopedia, but this is just going to be basically a summary of my ownership experience. Anyway, on with the rest of the video. So as I've mentioned on a lot of videos now on my E30, the timing belt changes on these M20 engines is pretty crucial, and it's probably one of the main service items that's specific to this car as well. Now, BMW recommends a cam belt change, I think, of about every 60,000 miles. However, I have heard stories of them breaking before that, so generally the recommendation now is that you should change it every 50,000 miles. However, you know, with this being a 30-year-old car, a lot of the time 50,000 miles could be done over many years now, maybe 15 years. So realistically, I think a good guide to go off is probably change the cam belt every 3 or 4 years, or 50,000 miles if you do use them that much. Now, when doing the cam belt change, there's actually a bunch of other things that it's worth doing at the same time, just because you have to take a lot of the cooling system out and a bunch of the other covers as well. So it could be worth changing things such as the viscous fan clutch as well, because that's a relatively cheap part. I think it's about £30 to £40. And as I say, once all that cooling system's out, it's much, much easier to do that. Now, another item that's again easier to access once you've got all that cooling system out is the water pump. And this is absolutely recommended to do with every cam belt change. Again, that's literally like a £20 or £25 part. So it really does just make sense to change that while you're in there. One of the other things I did change on mine as well is the distributor cap, because that was kind of worn out. And in fact, it broke in a couple of places when I took it off mine. So again, I think that was only about £35. So it just kind of made sense to change that anyway while I was in there. And I would probably recommend doing that if it's original ignition equipment as well. So one of the other key features actually of the M20 engine is it does have quite a loud valve train. So after a while, the lifters do get a bit out of adjustment. So you might notice a little bit of valve tick, especially when the car's up and running and out on the road and stuff. You can kind of notice that a little bit more. So yeah, you might want to just be checking the valve clearances quite frequently. I mean, it doesn't need to be done all the time, but especially if you do hear a little bit of ticking noise coming from the engine whilst out on the road, it can be worth checking the valve clearances and getting that adjusted. Again, this is really a pretty easy task to do. You'll find loads of instructions online. So one of the other key things with older cars in general is you want to make sure that fluid changes are done pretty frequently, and oil changes are obviously a main one, and you just want to be checking the condition of that oil pretty frequently. Actually, you can just pull the dipstick out and you're looking for something that's kind of like a brown color. If an oil's gone black, it's usually kind of past its best and probably won't lubricate as well as it should. I'm not sure exactly on the service intervals for oil changes, but E30s do actually have a built-in system that records that anyway. Unfortunately, a lot of people don't reset this when oil changes are done. So the main thing I'd recommend is just pull out that dipstick and check the condition of the oil. And as soon as it's been in there a couple of years, you probably want to be changing it anyway, just to keep the M20 engine in the best shape it can be. Another thing which kind of ties back to the cam belt changes is coolant changes. Again, like I said, a lot of that cooling system comes out when you do the cam belt change. So it really does just make sense to flush the whole system, put brand new coolant in, and yeah, make sure it's good high quality stuff as well. Generally, people would probably recommend the BMW coolant for these engines, which isn't all that expensive, to be honest. So as I've mentioned in previous videos, the E30s actually run a front and rear subframe setup. And what that means is there's actually a load of different bushings, rubber bushings that is, that basically allow that suspension to function properly. Over time, the rubber bushings really can deteriorate and wear out. A lot of the time they can be even original if the car's not been looked after. And by that point, they're just really not doing the job properly. So it's definitely recommended to change those out if they're looking a bit worn out and they've not been done in recent years. I think there's some polybush options as well, which will last longer and make the car feel tighter, but generally just replacing them with new rubber bushings will make a world of difference to the suspension. So one of the other things, just from my experience, is exhaust setups. Again, this is something I was kind of briefly touched on in previous videos, but E30s come with a massive variety of different exhaust setups, and it depends on firstly the engine, but also with the engines there's multiple different variants again. So mine has what's known as the two-piece setup, which basically means the downpipe and front silencer are one piece and the rear silencer is another piece, aka it's two pieces overall. Some of them have like a two-piece sort of front silencer and downpipe, so the downpipe is one and that connects to a front silencer. Now, it took me a very long time to actually find the correct part number because a load of different websites quote the wrong one for the front silencer section, depending on whether it's the two or three parts. So what I'll do is I'll actually stick the part number for the correct two-piece full exhaust system, so the one-piece front silencer and downpipe, into the description so you can find that if you're after it. So another thing that's specific to the E30s is the tyre size, and these days it's quite a funny size actually, because we've got a 15-inch rim, it's a 205 section, but it's a 55 profile, so it's not the kind of tyre sizes that we see these days, so there are less and less options that fit the standard rims. These are the 15-inch BBS rims, and there's some 14s as well, and there's the 14-inch like bottle tops as well. So it's just something to be aware of, that it can be a little bit difficult to find the right tyre size, you don't have a massive selection, especially when it comes to the more premium tyres. Having said that, it wasn't too much of an issue, and I did manage to source four new ones earlier this year for mine, actually, at a relatively reasonable price as well. Okay, so as I mentioned at the start, I do want to cover some sort of less specific E30 items as well. Now, some of these include stuff like brake discs, brake pads, you've got the clutch as well. So I'll start on the brakes. This kind of varies a bit model to model. So on the likes of the 325i, I believe they all came with front and rear disc brakes, and the Tourings also came with front and rear disc brakes, I think, if it was above the 320i. Like I say, I don't know all the different variations there, but basically it varies a little bit. Now, in my case, I've got solid discs on the rear and ventilated discs on the front. So that's just something to be aware of as well. You've got that slight price differences, but generally actually brake parts are very much available for these. I have done a few checks online. I've had no issues sourcing basically every part, including the pad wear sensors as well, which unfortunately a lot of owners tend to cut at previous times when they had changed the pads. But yeah, generally all that stuff can be sourced these days, even if you've got the drum brakes as well. So that's really handy. As I said, the clutch is another thing. On the E30s, we've got a setup where it's a master and slave cylinder, which is pretty commonplace. And yeah, generally the slave cylinder can be a little bit fiddly to do, and it's one of the things that does fail. I believe, checking the history on mine, I think it has been done fairly recently, but it's just something to be aware of as well. You may have issues with that down the line. And I also think a lot of these run the original clutch discs as well. So again, that's another thing that you may have to change at some point. However, the clutches are fairly easy to do just because there's not too much stuff guarding the whole gearbox assembly, and it can pretty much be dropped out in a reasonably short amount of time actually. So it's not too bad a job from what I've heard and read online. One final thing is the starter motor. That kind of ties into any clutch work actually, because if the gearbox is removed, it becomes much easier to access the starter motor itself. So again, it's one of those things that might just be worth changing if you're in there with the clutch or doing the slave cylinder or something like that. So there was also a couple of items I just wanted to mention in regards to a car that is like 30 or 40 years old, like a lot of these 80s and 90s cars are. So the main thing for me is trying to keep them as clean as possible wherever you can. In a lot of Europe over winter, there's a lot of salt that gets chucked out on the roads, and if that starts to build up both on the bodywork and the underside, it can really cause some rust issues over time. So I know if I'm taking this out over winter, I will try to wash it as soon after as I can, just to try and remove as much of that salt as possible and prevent any rust from building up. Speaking of rust, there's a couple of things that you can do to obviously prevent that. On the undersides, they're generally pretty well coated from factory, but after kind of like 25, 30 years, that coating has tended to like wear out a bit. But you can obviously buy this and recoat a lot of the different sections yourself, and it's probably worth doing if you really do want to prevent that rust from forming. So it can also be worth maybe putting a wax on the paint as well, again, just to help shed some of that dirt and not let it build up if you're not able to wash it as frequently. But again, I mean, this is just my experience from doing things. A lot of people aren't as bothered about that, but I do think it's worth doing if you want to protect the bodywork of the car. One final thing is, if you're a UK owner, I think actually at the minute all E30s will have to still sit in MOT. When a car becomes 40 years old in the UK, it becomes exempt from an MOT. So it's just something to be aware of as well, because there's obviously a few things on older cars that can be problematic at the time when it needs to go for an MOT. So you just want to be keeping an eye on the general condition of the car overall to make sure it is going to pass that test. Having said that, the test in the UK isn't the most strict. They tend to be fairly lenient on some things, as well as trying to make sure the car is actually safe, of course. So it's not too much of an issue. You've just got to keep an eye on things and make sure you're aware of all the different things on the car that could potentially go wrong as well. Okay guys, so that's the end of the video. I hope you found it useful. Like I say, this was just kind of like summarizing all the maintenance items on E30s, mainly from my experience and things that I picked up through my ownership experience as well. I hope you found it useful. As I say, there's a bunch of other videos that we've done on this actually, and I'll link the playlist down below in case you want to check out some of those others. That's all from us today. I hope you enjoyed, and thanks for watching.